that tonight I wouldn't shoot my video. I had so many problems on my computer. I'm not going to explain everything, but basically I couldn't download the photos and videos on my computer. It was a mess. So I went to the show for the release of the album Slow Light by Dirty Verdi. There was this show at the Gold Diggers where I already went to see them. I especially love this place. They were not the only one to play. There was Detangler first and also Gregory Ullman, usually who is in the band Fell Runner, that I went to see at Ecoplex. I filmed with two different cameras. I'm going to explain why. The camera I use is actually my iPhone. The camera is really good on my iPhone. It's a rather recent iPhone that I have, so I'm using that, but I'm always afraid not to have enough space on my iPhone because I take a lot of photos and I film a lot. I empty it very often, but sometimes it's becoming full, so I try to avoid that. So that's why I had another camera, which is not the quality is not as good, of course. It makes the job, but it's not the same quality. So usually I keep my iPhone for Dirty Verdi because I came to film Dirty Verdi originally, and I started taking the other camera for the other artists. But they were so good, Detangler as Gregory Ullman, that I thought at a point they deserve to have a good image on my camera and it must be well filmed. So you will see some images which are not so good and some images which are better. I apologize for that, but now you know why. It's not because I film badly and then I film really well. No, it's two different cameras. So I went to the show. They said the doors open at 8, so I think I arrived around 8, something like that. They said that Detangler was going to play at 8:15. I was sitting on a bench on the right when we are watching the stage. Detangler went on the stage just when I arrived. He was trying a few things and he started playing. And I started filming. I'm laughing because I was maybe a little tired because I was, we say, à côté de la plaque in French. It means beside my shoes. I was completely beside my shoes. I understood everything wrongly. Anyway, so first he started playing, but he was not finishing a song. He was stopping his laptop. And I thought, he's very relaxed when he plays. And he was also singing, but not completely, not really. So I started thinking, that's weird. Actually, I was filming the balance. When I say the balance, I mean the sound check. He was doing the sound check and I thought that he was doing the show already. So I filmed and I was about to erase that because it was not the show. But actually, I kept the shots and I'm glad that I did, because you see, very often on the demo, when an artist or a composer or a singer do a song, very often on the demos, as I was saying before in previous videos, sometimes they are better than on the finished product. And during the balance, at a point he was playing the guitar, it was so good that I thought, oh no, I must not erase that. And I was right, because I think that for one song he almost played better during the sound check than when it was the show. So I'm glad that I kept these shots. Anyway, while he was doing the sound check, I could hear already that he was playing the guitar really well. So I was glad to discover Detangler. Very often on Instagram, I'm following pages where they show guitarists playing famous riffs, like, for example, Led Zeppelin riffs or things like that. Basically, every day I'm listening to Led Zeppelin on Instagram because there is always someone who wants to play a riff, a famous riff of Led Zeppelin. So it was like if I was in front of someone like that, someone, he was not playing Led Zeppelin, but he was playing the guitar really well, except that it was not on Instagram, it was just in front of me. So that was pleasant to listen to. I thought, okay, I didn't come for nothing anyway, it starts really well. So then he stopped the sound check. It's when I realized that it was not the show but the sound check. He was wearing a tie and dye t-shirt, really nice. I must say, I love tie and dye. I'm always training myself on tie and dye, and I never managed to do perfectly the thing, but I'm fascinated by tie and dye. That's why I'm talking about his t-shirt. So then he came back to start the show, and he was wearing this long coat. I thought a dress, no, not a dress, like a long vest, maybe like a coat, but very colorful. I mean, it was almost like an Harlequin print. And I thought, that's weird. His coat looks a little like a robe. But I didn't think it was a robe. I thought it was a costume for the stage. And I thought, oh, at least he makes an effort to go on the stage. She's wearing something fancy for the stage. But at a point, I realized that it was a robe. And I started wondering during the whole show, why is he wearing a robe? So maybe I should ask him. So he was wearing this robe. So I thought, oh, I should have come with my robe. Why him and not me? After all, it's very comfortable to wear a robe. It probably had a meaning, I suppose. At a point he said, because he was saying funny things between the songs, he wanted to make a phone call. And I thought, oh, he's really very relaxed on stage. To make a phone call in front of us. And actually it was prepared. It was like a sketch. It was a part of the show. And I understood that after. So I thought all the time, okay, I understood nothing since I arrived. I don't know how to define musics and styles, but there is some things which made me think of something a little jazzy, a little Steely Dan. I'm sorry for the references, I have the references of my age. So I thought about Steely Dan. was not only jazzy, it was a little funky. You have the funk, my friend. Anyway, it was a little funky. Thought of Santana at a point. I thought of Jimi Hendrix. So I'm not saying that he plays as Jimi Hendrix, no. But let's say that Santana and Jimi Hendrix crossed my mind while listening to him. That's all what I want to say. So basically he was alone on stage. He only had computers or laptops, and he had a pedal and his electric guitar and his voice. Sometimes he was not singing. At the end, he was only singing, not playing the guitar, but everything was already recorded. So it was very digital, I mean it was not acoustic at all. Well, he plays guitar really well. I really enjoyed it. I laughed a lot because he was very funny between the songs. And he seemed very relaxed on stage, and I did appreciate that. He was actually relaxed on stage, so it made us relax as well. And well, he was good. I don't know if he toured a lot or not, if he has been doing this job since a long time or not. I have no idea. I don't know if he's a beginner or if he's an accomplished artist. I have no idea. It had something very spontaneous and fresh. And that's what I like. I like when I see something spontaneous and fresh, because very often it's when we get the best. It doesn't mean that artists must not become professional then. Of course, they improve themselves and they progress and they evolve, of course. But I like to watch when it's a little quirky. So then it was Gregory Ullman. So Gregory Ullman, you must know that he's a part of the band, as I was saying, Fell Runner. But it's not only that. He also produced and mixed the last Dirty Verdi's album with Tim Carr, who I think is also in Fell Runner, because I think that I recognized him. And I'm wondering if Tim Carr is not playing the drums behind Gregory Ullman, if I'm right. Usually when I see a face, it's rare that I forget the face. I remember people. So I just tell you that not only Gregory Ullman is a part of Fell Runner, but also he worked with Dirty Verdi on the mix and on the production for the last album, Slow Light. He was there like a guest, but also like a friend, like someone they work with. He was really good. I recognized his style because he was singing sometimes with Fell Runner when I saw them at Echoplex, and I really thought that there was a big difference between when he was singing and when the other singer was singing. There was really a big difference in the style, and when Gregory Ullman sang alone, I recognized his style that he had when he was playing with Fell Runner. So Carrie Stevens, she came to sing with him for the I think it was the two first songs. It was completely unexpected, as they decided that at the last minute. It was not planned. Carrie Stevens, you know her, she was from Kiddie Band and I filmed them, and she also played for the two Marcolis and Tok Tok tributes. She's the one who was playing there also. She's a very good singer and a very good musician. I'm amazed by how she's able to go from one thing to the other, and she's very comfortable. I especially loved one song by Gregory Ullman. There was one song that I knew before. But I cannot tell you which one anymore, because now that I heard the other ones, I have a very good memory for the music. So now I know them all. I mean, I know all the songs that I heard at the show. Now I know them all. So I cannot remember which one I knew before. And why did I know that song before? So maybe he played it with Fairrunner at Ecoplex, maybe. Maybe I heard it online, on Instagram. I don't know. I cannot remember, but when he started the song, I thought, oh, I know this one. I fell through to the end. It's very calm, very soothing music. He's not an excited guy. There was one song which was a little more dynamic. Gregory, very nice guy. I went to see him after. And if it were up to me, actually, Dietengler as Gregory, they are both very nice. Dietengler, very funny. When I left, he was outside. Dietengler, he was about to leave in a car and he said, hello, bye, to me like that. Like if we were old friends. He was very funny. At the beginning, I was like, who is talking to? No, it was to me. Gregory is very nice too. They are all very nice. All very nice people. Then the stars were Dirty Verdi. I was coming for them. My first thought is they are not shy musicians starting anymore. I mean, they became really, really professional. I'm surprised because they evolved so fast. I've met them June, July, August, September, October. Okay, I met them 5 months ago. It's not so far. It's even not the half of a year. I already have the feeling it's not the same band anymore, already. Is it because they tour a lot, they play a lot, they do a lot of shows? Maybe at the beginning they were already professional, but maybe they were a little shy in front of me. I don't know. Maybe it's possible. However, I watched some videos that were filmed before. They knew me. They seem to me less professional then. They are not beginners because Dirty Verdi exists since a very long time now. I think it's something like 10 years. So they are not beginners. They have toured a lot. They have played a lot live. It's their fifth album, the new album, the fifth one. I will do a video on this album. I cannot talk about the show and the album in the same time because I have so much to say on this album and I have a little to say on the show, so I don't want my video to be so long. It's not new for them to release an album, so we cannot say that they are beginners. They are not beginners. They are professional. I think that for this show, I saw them more like true professional. The only thing is that the stage was really small at Gold Diggers. It's very tight. And I think that there were a little too many on the stage. So they were like stuck against each other. It was a little like that, you know. So the result of that is that Ivan was in front of Andrew. Andrew is the drummer. Ivan is the second guitarist. And yes, Ivan was in front of Andrew. So when I'm filming, we cannot really see Andrew. So Andrew, I'm sorry. I didn't do that purposely. It's not my fault. It was because they were placed like that. I couldn't see Andrew. If I had been on the other side, I could have seen Andrew, but then I wouldn't have seen maybe Randy, who was at the keyboard. It was a little complicated to film and to have everybody on my camera. I tried to do my best. So they started with Your Ghost. So according to me, Your Ghost is the hit of the album. According to me, that's my taste, that's what I say. I'm not a professional, someone else is going to say something else. Anyway, according to me, Your Ghost is the hit. If I have one thing to say about the show, which wouldn't be a compliment, it's not something bad either. I just want to say why the audience is more excited than the people on the stage. I had difficulties to stay still while filming because I'm a little excited when I listen to music. There was in the audience a girl who was screaming a lot and dancing, and actually with her boyfriend they were dancing on the music. And I tried to film them and to take photos. The problem is that it was so dark in the audience. I didn't manage really to get a good photo of them. But they were right. They were in the right mood for the show, especially Your Ghost. Which is probably the most... No, it's not the most dynamic song. There are two other songs which are also dynamic. No, what I'm saying... There are four other songs which are also dynamic, two from this album, two which are not in this album. So it was rather a dynamic set that I heard. But what is wrong with these people on stage, these young people? So I understand that they are playing, they have a job to do, they are not there to have fun, they are there to work. And maybe they are a little scared. I mean, they are used to go on stage, but it was a big deal. It was for the release of the album, so it was a little different. Except Ivan. Ivan, he's very dynamic on stage. And of course, Andrew on the drums, he has to be dynamic because it's his job to be dynamic on the drums. But the other ones, they were a little stiff, a little like, well, Randy, it's difficult to say because he's behind the keyboard and he's not supposed to jump all over the place. He's supposed to be on his keyboard. But the other ones were a little, and I wanted to say, come on, young people, dance, move, be excited as this girl who was a little tipsy. I agree with that. She was seriously tipsy, but she should have come on stage and danced. She was in the right mood for that song and on many songs, actually. Anyway, they were maybe not moving and excited, but the music was very dynamic. Song Waking the Dream. Dream was at the end of Waking the Dream, I already said that in a previous video, the end of that song reminds me something. I found what it reminds me. I will talk about that when I will talk about the album. I will tell you what it makes me think of. So Waking the Dream was the first single released. The third song was Arcturus. When I saw them on stage live for the first time at the Love Song Bar, I don't talk about the tribute, I mean for Dirty Verdi. So I saw them play live and I heard Arcturus for the first time there. Remember what I said? I said that I could see someone in pain. I think I was right. I had the right feeling from the very beginning. Well, the lyrics are... I will talk about the lyrics when I will talk about the album. I nailed it from the very beginning with this song. And actually, I persist to think that this song in particular is very overwhelming. It's a waltz. I want to waltz. I want to waltz on it. There is one thing with Dirty Verdi is that the melodies, they are brilliant. Each song has a very excellent melody. There are several melodies in each song, but each song is so wonderfully written. The lyrics are beautiful. The melodies are beautiful. The album is incredibly done. The lives are incredibly played. They are becoming better and better. Honestly, when I met them, I wouldn't have imagined that 5 months later they would be where they are. I'm very surprised to be so right. was so right from the very beginning. It's confirmed more and more every time I hear them. So follow them. There is something there. You know, people like that, if they did a Margulies and Tok Tok tribute, it's because they are very good. That's it. I love the girl who is screaming every time.
That song was called Arcturus. All these so far off our new album just came out on Friday last week. Thank you. Yeah. We've got some CDs for sale over there, and it's streaming everywhere now. Woohoo!
So while I'm here, I'm showing you the CD. So it's like that. I will talk about the album and the CD in another video. But I'm just showing you because I bought it there. So on the other side, you have the list of the songs written like that. The design has been made by Ryan Qualls, that I know. I know him. He's a very talented man. So here you have all the credits. Yes, the credits are there, the CD is there. And here you have a little booklet with the lyrics inside. The layout of the lyrics is very interesting. A little complicated to read, but I like the way how it is made. There are 10 songs on this album. They are like very discreet doodlings, like, you know, some imperfections like that, or... Let me show you. Yes, for example, like if someone was trying a pen, or like if someone was doing corrections. You know, when you do correction on a book before it's printed, you do corrections like that. I know because I used to work for a publisher during a long time. So with little doodles and things, it makes me think a little when I'm journaling. Sometimes I have some imperfections like that, and I love these imperfections, like here, little lines. I really like that. That is my artistic aspect, which makes me say that maybe you won't like that. No, I like the design, and what I like the most on the album is that the fact that the photo takes the whole space of the front. What I mean is that there is not a frame. If there was a frame, or if the photo was smaller, it would have accentuated the retro aspect of the photo, because the photo is from the end of the 70s. Honestly, I would have thought, I don't know, for me it looks like 30s, from the 30s. It looks very retro. There is a kind of sadness in these photos. Let's say it's not joyful. I think it's better to say it like that. But when you put the photo on the whole space like that, it doesn't give the same feeling. It looks more modern. It looks more now. Then there was a black painting night. So that was the fourth song. Like a flower adorned in black hair. Black Painting Night also has a very European feeling. Same thing, first time I heard this song, I thought, oh, it sounds really very, very French. And it's not the only song. I talked about that for Northern Star also, but it's not the only one. If you go on their first album, the one Sleepy EP, there is one song, I will talk about it later. There is one song which also made me think of a part of the song, of something very French movie. It's very surprising that a young American guy composes like that. So the fifth song was Jigsaw. So Jigsaw I don't know, but I hear it more and more dynamic. More I listen to it, more I feel it dynamic. Same thing, I would have loved to see them a little more dynamic on this song on stage. I mean, I'm not asking them to be like Mick Jagger and jumping all over the place. That's not what I'm saying. It's just that, come on, they are young. I'm old. I shouldn't be jumping all over the place. And I do. When I listen to that, I'm excited. Then the sixth song was Above the Flood, so it's a part of the album too. They played it by a very acoustic way, just Jonathan and Dylan. I love that. I love when they play together. It's always so excellent when they play together. But Dylan played that at the hi-hat a few weeks ago alone. He played this song alone. It was excellent too. But I really like also when he plays with Jonathan. I love the acoustic aspect of this song. Such a nice melody. And then Avalon. So the excited girl, a little tipsy in the audience, she was very excited on the song. And I understand, because it's a very exciting song. She was screaming, especially at the end. Have you felt it? So it's the eighth song. Same thing, it's a very dynamic song. Even if the lyrics are terribly sad, the song was played by a very dynamic way. The girl in the audience was very, very excited again. And I was too. I love this song. I love all the songs, but I really love Have You Felt It? Dylan asked me which song I preferred on the album. It's very difficult to say, because they are all so different, and one day I'm going to prefer this one, the next day I'm going to prefer another one. It's very difficult to say which one I prefer. It's like kids, when you have children, you don't say I prefer him rather than him. You love them all. It's exactly the same for the songs on this album. I must think about it. I will say it when I will talk about the album. At the end, Ivan played the bagpipes part. Not bagpipes, it's what I was saying when I was talking about have you felt it on another video. There is a part played by the electric guitar. On the album, and it makes me think of bagpipes, and I love this part. So then they play turns. So Churn is absolutely not on the new album. Churn is on this album, Meander Belt, which is the album before this one. I love Churn. I love Turn. And then they played Let Me In. I am standing at your door. This song, especially because of the end, there is a psychedelic moment that I absolutely love at the guitars. I love this song, and you know, when I think about it, the first time that I listened to Let Me In, I know why I loved so much this psychedelic part at the end, because it was making me think of Jimmy Page in Led Zeppelin. I used to listen to Led Zeppelin when I was very young, when I was a child, and they played it. Oh, wow! So this song is on Let Me Be a Light. It's the album before Meander Belt. So that is the third album. That is the fourth album. That is the fifth album.
Thank you guys, thank you so much. We got Randy Kirk on keys, John Schwartz on bass, Andrew Lesman on drums, Emery on guitar. Come get a record. Thank you so much.
I have the feeling to see a star being born in front of me. I'm sure that they will do something. I'm sure that they will become something. I can feel it. I hope that you like this video. I wanted to share with you what I saw in the show. It's my way of taking you with me. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and comment if you want to. Okay, bye bye.